Earlier, he was associated with HSBC Bank, Middle East, Citibank, Tata Motors in various capacity of high order. Mr. Bhatnagar had been an accountable executive for Rs. 1,000 crore star scheme to skill 1 million youth in India in 1 year. He was chosen as the male diversity champion from 1,500 nominees for Barclays Bank's global pool of employees. He has also been awarded the best COO in Barclays Africa. Mr. Bhatnagar has also featured on the front cover of Business Journal Africa. I would take privilege to welcome him on the dais, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here, and I'd like to thank Dr. Mahapatra for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to speak to you all. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to you all. I'd like to share some parts of my banking experience, and I'm being fortunate to be associated with three major banks like Citibank, HSBC and Barclays in three different countries. Now, I started my career with Citibank way back in 1990. And I was part of the team which set up the credit card business in Madras. And the very first card came out at that time. Now, it also, the learning there was we had to change our mindset. And I'll tell you why I'm mentioning this here. The mindset of a bank is customers and typically through branches. Now, Citibank had only 6 branches in India. Even now, I don't think it's more than 20 also, maybe less in fact. And we were embarking on a credit card program where we had nearly 1.5 million customers on credit cards and 50,000 bank accounts. So Citibank was actually behaving like a credit card company rather than a bank, because RBI wouldn't allow it to make any more brick and mortar style. So I'm just leaving the thought in your mind, and I'll bring this thought back later. Do we really need banks to issue a credit card or a payment mechanism? So that means most of the customers, 95% of the credit card customers were not bank customers. Yeah, they didn't have an account. Yet, Citibank was supporting them. Now, later on, I mean, my last assignment was with Barclays in Kenya. And Kenya is very unique. It was the, and it is continues to be the pioneer of mobile banking. In 2005, they started. Small country. Little back of beyond, I mean, some people would have known it for Masai Mara and tourism. I stayed there for 4 years. I was the CEO for Barclays. And I saw some very amazing things happening. I reached there when there were riots going on because the elections had happened and the two parties, there was some rigging, etc. And they were not really behaving themselves. And there were a lot of killing and everything happening on the road. So banks were all shut. Yet the country was going on. The citizens were not bothered. As part of the bank, I used to have regular pressures of the media coming to me, when are you opening your bank's ATM and when is the branch going to be opened? I was a new guy to the whole landscape. I had a pretty difficult time that way. But the average customer and the guy on the street, and especially the poor, they were very happy. There was no problem. I mean, happy not because the riots were on, but their daily life was not getting bothered. Why? Because they had mobile banking. So you want to buy bread, you want to send money to your parents, or you want to get money from somewhere else, and grocery shopping, etc., everything on the mobile, they're going left, right, and that's okay. It was the rich were a problem, because they wanted to send their NEFTs and RTGSs and huge amounts from one place to the other, and the bank was shut. So what do they do? So the poor were very happy. So I found there, hey, look, this is a great thing. I mean, mobile banking, reaching to the poor, and it became a social movement lately. To give you some stats, I mean, Kenya has got a population of some 36 million people. 4 million people are banked, and 26 million people actually do money transfers through the mobile. So what happens to this 4 million, 26 million minus 4 million? They don't have a bank account. For them, their mobile number is the bank account. And there's no bank at the background. There is no bank. And that is the telco that is supporting you, which is Safaricom, and M-Pesa is the product. So the mobile number itself becoming a bank account is a very revolutionary idea for them. And I've seen that work, and working very fine there. Now, it has ingrained into the society so much that the domestic staff that I had when I was staying, I mean, my maid, my driver, the gardener, the security guard. You have to have security guards if you're to be in Kenya. So all of them would say, Saab, mobile se paise na. I don't want to take cash because it's a very risky proposition because people can mug you and take your wallet away, etc. You lose your monthly earnings. Everything on the mobile. And, well, not the greatest of examples, but I can tell you that even if you kind of, if somebody skips a red light, same thing situation as in India, traffic cop hails you, pulls you down and kind of says, want to settle it out of court types, and demands a certain amount of money, there, well, here you have to give some notes, etc. There, the guy just comes and drops one small sheet of paper which has a mobile number. You pay the mobile and then you're through. I mean, no challan gets cut. So even in those kind of things, so right from buying your bread to booking your air ticket, you can use a mobile. Best part is, I mean, if I'm sending my son out, he's like a 12-year-old guy, wants to go and celebrate his birthday in a mall, takes his 4 or 5 people, friends or whatever, they go for a movie, they go for, have some pizzas, etc. And they don't want parents to be around. Now, you can't give them 5,000 rupees or 5,000 shillings in India, in Kenya terms, because that's money, young minor, what will he do? Somebody might take the money from him. And you don't want to be there because otherwise you have to swipe your credit card and send interference with your son's birthday party. What he would do is he'll have his party, get his whole thing, give me a call, Dad, 5,000 rupees to be paid at Pizza Hut. This is the merchant code and I could do a mobile transfer immediately. So, and I could have been in Hong Kong, I could have done the same thing because after all, you just need a mobile and access and that goes through. Now, that brings me to the point where we are. Now, we've talked about 1.2 billion Indians and 700 million bank accounts, 900 million odd mobile phones. Aadhaar being 1.1 billion or some such number that's coming up. So if we change our mindset from a customer to a citizen, a lot of things can change in our mind. Customer, as I'm thinking, a bank customer means you have to have a bank account, you have to have a branch somewhere, you have to belong somewhere to some brick and mortar place where you sign forms. And banks have been pushed into making branches. Branches are not making money. And obviously you are, you have got some delivery to be made to your stakeholders in terms of dividends, etc. So you can't be getting into non-profitable businesses. The government try and push you into that. And you're trying to make, I mean, the private banks are making a lot of noise, not wanting to get into multi-branch situation. So how would Aadhaar being the bank account? Or the mobile holder. I mean, in order to have cash in your pocket, you don't have to have a bank account. Anybody can give you cash and for services rendered or wherever you have got it. Nobody says ki for cash you have to have a bank account. So, can I convert the cash into electronic cash? And can it be against my Aadhaar number? And Aadhaar number is linked to my finger or print or biometric kind of situation. So, I don't need to have a bank account. And Aadhaar becomes my... And using technology... With all these other... There, now, a simple thing. I mean, I learned this from NSDC when we were opening accounts and doing direct debit transfers in 2013, way before the Jan Dhan Yojana came in. We transferred money to nearly 862,000 people through the bank accounts itself. But how do you make them use the bank account? And these are newly opened bank accounts. And it's very true. There will be zero balance, like the Jan Dhan, a lot of inactivity on it. Now, how do I place in that user's mind what good is this bank account? And he or she is worried about income tax bracket and people having a look at his account, etc. But what works best is, can I do my mobile recharge of 50 rupees with that account? For that, I don't have to go out in the sun and find an Airtel shop and try and get a recharge done. Can I, sitting in my home, debit my bank account, credit my recharge, and add 50 bucks? Not only for me, as a youth, can I do it for my girlfriend? Or as a senior person, can I do it for my wife? Can I do it for my mother? Without having to go out. So that 50 rupees makes a difference. Then can I make it 100? Maybe I can do it twice. Can I make it 150? And I slowly start looking at that bank account more respectfully. Yeah. So the usage of
how do I use that account? How do I? So we are talking of awareness, but when you're talking of awareness, you have to give a solid use of how I make use of that account to make it more, let's say, you know, transactional. The more transactional it becomes, of course, then later on you can do creditworthiness, etc., and all that. So in Kenya, they were talking about how people earning less than $2 a day, that's like 130 rupees. How can I promote savings for people earning less than 2 rupees a day? So at the end of the day, if they have got 5 rupees left in their account, can I immediately put into a recurring deposit on a daily basis? Next day he saves another 5 rupees, 10 rupees on a recurring basis. Now all this does not require a bank to be visited, some 5 rupees to be put into the account, and some another 5 rupees, because that would be huge. I mean, Indian population so much that everybody starts, like you've got these queues running as we speak online in ATMs in mobile, it'll be hell. But using a mobile, if I can keep increasing that amount of 5 rupees to 10 and 15 and 50, suddenly I'm giving a recurring. So maybe he earns 8 rupees at the end of the day as interest over a month or something, but it is still saving. So the Belinda and Bill Gates Foundation, they made this offer. Okay, look, can we have technology to promote that? So the reason I'm bringing these topics out is, okay, look, can we use what is most prevalent, which is Aadhaar, because we need to have an identity of a customer. This country has been typically lacking. If we don't have, I mean, our names are very common. If I say Amit Kumar, there will be 1 lakh people raising their hands. If I say Mr. Subramaniam, there might be 5 lakh people raising their hands also. So how do I differentiate one Subramaniam from another and one Amit Kumar from another? Biometric seems to have kind of cracked that case. Can we make it more prevalent? Can I now start using, I mean, I have a very funny thought here. Okay, look, in due time, there will be no point in having names and all. The names are will become irrelevant. The only two things that are going to define you uniquely is your Aadhaar card and your mobile. Aadhaar card will give you identity, numeric identity, which can be uniquely traced back to you through technology and otherwise. And phone will be your accessibility, so you can talk to you at any time if you want. Name will be quite irrelevant, very frankly. But anyway, that's a different thought. But what I wanted to use was what this country has already established, which is in Aadhaar, and if the Prime Minister and the government are both pushing that forward, then that is the way we can look at bridging the gap which is currently existing with 700 million accounts and 1.2 million population, and Aadhaar being somewhere in between. Next, usage of that account is going to make people understand, you know, importance of that mobile phone accessibility. Third, savings using the mobile itself is going to increase their own, let's say, their own wealth, so-called. I mean, start small, becoming bigger. And finally, if all this were to happen the way we are thinking, and it can very frankly happen, I mean, Paytm has started, they got 210 million customers, as the previous speaker just said, but can we now make it bigger and more prevalent? And there can be multiple players in the market. That's great. I mean, that's an open market situation. More the competition, the better the offerings, the better the technology, and we'll all work towards that. But finally, when we come to this Aadhaar issue, what will happen with this mobile transfers and this electronic money is that it's not about then, look, minorities and rural and women, etc. Everybody, it's an equal opportunity for everybody. And then further, I mean, if I again break the kind of cut the cake a little more between that 1.2 billion to 700 million, in order to go to a bank, somebody has to be a little literate. I'm literate in the sense to look at the terms and conditions. Nobody looks at it, but anyway, you get sometimes framed against something you've done, and the bank starts charging you money. You say, I was never told. It happens to the best of us, so what about the rural population? That's where technology can bridge the gap. And that technology is typically the Siri in your fort or the Cortana or the OK Google. I mean, I say OK Google, my phone brings to life and says, I say, set an appointment for me. So the population between that 1.2 billion and the 700 million bank customers are actually illiterate. They do not know how to read or write. but they know how to speak. They know how to communicate because they've got a mobile phone and they can talk. And that is all also in vernacular. I mean, India has to be seen as not one country, it's 29 different countries in one. UP being the 10th largest country in the world, very frankly. So with each vernacular thing, can I have a voice-to-text technology where the person can speak out an instruction and carry out the instruction with his voice pattern? So that will make it even more. So because, you know, if you look at some of our senior citizens and you give them a mobile, they feel quite scared, and very true. I mean, even I would be scared maybe at that age because something new would have come in. They're worried about pressing a few buttons and kind of worried if they look, something might blow up. But if they can speak like the way they will speak to their father, they would get that thing done. So this is the only ideas that I had so far, but I would be happy to have any questions. Thank you.